Welcome to this production by the Sunlight Players of Moments in Time. We ask, as a courtesy to the performers and to the audience here, that you would turn off all electronic devices and that you please not use any flash photography during the performance, because that will just be a distraction for those around you. Again, welcome. I trust that you will enjoy what you're about to see as we begin our time of Holy Week, as we prepare for Easter Day, that Resurrection Day. Let us open with prayer. Gracious God, we come before you this afternoon. We give you thanks for this opportunity we have this day. Lord, we ask that you would be with each of the players as they bring your story to life for us. And be with each one of us, that we would be open to the message that you have for us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
master wash their feet?
Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son might glorify thee. Keep in thy name those given to me. I do not pray for these alone, but for all those who will believe in me through their word. Amen.
Nathaniel.
How are you?
Where's Didymus? Oh. Good. Oh, good. We have wine and cheese.
Nathaniel, oh, what good. Quiet. The guards are out in force tonight.
Tonight, as part of our Lenten season celebration, we want to look closely at a famous religious painting, The Last Supper, by Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo was born in Vinci, Italy, in 1452, and as Vinci's most famous personality, is universally known as Leonardo da Vinci. Although he excelled as a sculptor, scientist, inventor, and engineer, he is remembered primarily because of two of his paintings, the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper. In 1494, Leonardo was commissioned by the Duke of Milan to decorate the front wall of the dining area of the Church of Santa Maria del Grazie in Milan, Italy. There was no hesitation about the choice of a theme for the painting. What could be more appropriate for a dining area than the Last Supper held in the large upper room? Leonardo chose to portray the moment just after our Lord had said,
I say to you, the hand of he that betrayeth me is with me at this table.
Instantly, the 12 apostles became men of 12 different moods and personalities. Only Jesus himself remained composed. In the excitement, one of them overturns a container of salt. One of them draws a knife. Some of them look at Jesus. Others gaze at each other in disbelief. Tonight, we will construct a living reproduction of this moment during the Last Supper, much as Leonardo did in his painting. We will look at the personalities of these 12 men, each of whom asks himself, is it I who will betray the Master?
I am Philip, and I come from Bethsaida in Galilee. While several of my friends and I were in Bethany, listening to John the Baptist, Jesus called us to be his disciples. So we turned and followed him. I went after my companion Nathanael, and I told him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph.
I am known as
Bartholomew to some, Nathaniel to others. Like many of my friends, I am a fisherman. My home is in Cana of Galilee, where Jesus performed his first miracle, turning water into wine at a wedding feast. At first, I was skeptical. Jesus of Nazareth? Filthy, immoral place. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?
Come and see.
When I met Jesus, it was like he already knew me. Like he knew my innermost thoughts. Now, although I've always been a devout man, I realized that Jesus was offering me something more intimate and more personal than my religion had ever offered before.
During these years of close fellowship with Jesus, my faith in God has grown stronger and deeper. When he told us that God was our Father in heaven, it was almost more than I could comprehend. But as I listened to the Master, I grew to understand his words.
He said to me, "Behold an Israelite in whom there is no guile."
How did he know you?
He said that before you called me, when I was under the fig tree, he saw me. It was then that I confessed my faith. And I said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel."
You know, I remember when he fed the 5,000 with the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, asking him and the others where we might buy enough so that all may eat. Little did I know, Andrew was bringing a small lad with his lunch to Jesus. You know, I always wanted to know more about the nature and person of God. And now, in fact, I can almost say, in having seen Jesus, you've seen the Father.
We have walked with him through the villages of Galilee and the towns of Decapolis, and even through the streets of the holy city, Jerusalem. But now, as he is instituting a ceremony, which is to take the place of the Passover, he tells us that one of us is to betray him.
Having seen the Father in Jesus, he tells us there's a betrayer in our midst?
How can that be?
Does the betrayer not know that in betraying Jesus, you're betraying God? In conspiring against Jesus, you are conspiring against God?
How can a traitor be amongst his closest friends?
Can one of our numbers be so blind? Who could it be?
Is it I?
Is it I?
When my character changed through my relationship with Jesus, my name changed as well. I am now called Matthew, although some still call me Levi and others insist on calling me Matthew the publican. That is because, like Zacchaeus, I was a tax collector. I was at my table one day collecting taxes when Jesus walked by. "Follow me," he said. And I rose and I followed him. Later that day, I feast for him in my home. Many of his followers and my business associates were there. It was a royal occasion for me to entertain Jesus and his disciples. Afterwards, a number of the chief priests and Pharisees complained to Jesus about his eating with publicans and sinners. And Jesus said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, those who are sick." Then he reminded them of those words from Hosea, that "I desire mercy, not sacrifice." And he added significant words of his own, saying, "For I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Well, since that day, I have made a careful study of all the books of the law and the prophet, and I have determined that Jesus is the fulfillment of every prophecy regarding the coming of the Messiah, God's anointed. I've listened carefully to all his sermons regarding the, the good news of the kingdom of heaven, beginning with that sermon he gave 3 years ago on that mountaintop in Galilee. It is a new gospel. Good news to the whole world. And yet now he gives us bad news. Tragic news that one of us will betray him. Who could that be? Do they suspect me because I was once a hated tax collector? Do I suspect myself? Oh, Lord, is it I? Is it I? I.
Yes, I am Simon the Zealot. Although there are those who call me Simon Zelotes. Before Jesus called me, I belonged to a group of hot-headed, bloodthirsty revolutionaries known as the Zealots. We were all for armed rebellion against the kingdom of Rome. We believed in crushing our enemies beneath our heels and resurrecting that ancient glory that was once Israel's in the days of David and Solomon. Yet, Jesus told us of another kingdom, the kingdom of the human heart, when God reigns supremely. And since I've heard him, I've changed my mind and my allegiance. He has shown us that the conquest of the human heart is the most true, sincere, and everlasting conquest. Therefore, I have given him my highest loyalty and my deepest devotion. And in military parlance, I have unconditionally and completely surrendered myself to him, so that I may think his thoughts, to love as he loves, and to whom he loves, to serve as he serves, and to obey as he obeys. But this surrender has not imprisoned me. No, not this Simon. Rather, it has. It's freed me for the first time in my life. And I am no longer afraid of Rome. Rome is mighty, but God is almighty. And we will conquer Rome by outliving and outloving her. This Jesus has shown unto us. Jesus, who we call our Lord and Savior. But now, the Master says there is a spiritual Roman among us, one who will attempt by force what can only be conquered by love. Is it Matthew, the publican, or James, or John, or does he suspect me as I am the only former zealot among all of us? Is it I? Lord, is it I?
I am Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, the man who first brought his own brother to the Lord. I'm not a gifted man, but a simple, ordinary, average man. But yet I've tried to use the talents and the gifts that I do have to serve the Master. The others, they call me Andrew the Bringer, because it seems that all I've ever done is bring others to the Lord. Like my brother, Simon Peter, I brought him first to the Lord, and I glorified in my heart to watch the gradual transformation of his life. And the day that Jesus fed the 5,000 with the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, I was glad in my heart as I watched him feed so many with so little. And just recently, some Greeks came calling for Jesus, and I was called once again to bring them in. Jesus must have seen something in me that others haven't, because he named me as one of the 12. And since that time, we've become close. And then I know in my own heart that he is the Lamb of God. And yet this night he says that one of us is to betray him. How could they live with it on their own heart? It's unthinkable. Is it Andrew the bringer? Lord, is it I? Is it I?
My brother Andrew and I were fishing on the Sea of Galilee, casting our nets into the sea, when Jesus walked by. He said, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." So we laid down our nets, and we followed him. One morning he said, "Simon, put out into the deep and let your nets down for the catch." I said, "Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. But at your word, we will let down our nets." We caught so many fish, we had to summon nearby boats to help contain the catch. Upon reaching shore, I fell at his feet and said, "Depart from me, Lord, for I'm a sinful man." He said from then on that we'd be fishers of men. In fact, he changed my name from Simon to Peter, which means the rock. And when I confessed to him as Christ, the living Son of God near Caesarea Philippi, he said, "On this rock I will build my church." But a moment later, when I protested against him going to Jerusalem to die at the hands of these evil men, he rebuked me and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." This is who I am, a mixture of good and evil, godliness and devilishness. But I want to prove to him that my love and my loyalty and devotion are both genuine and sincere. Yet tonight, when he said one of us betray him, I promised to follow him even unto death. But he told me before the rooster crowed, I would deny him. He prayed for me. He said Satan wanted to sift me like wheat. Oh, they call me the big fisherman. In his eyes, I feel small and unworthy. Will I deny him before the rooster crows? And if I do, what will he do? Will he deny me? Will he disown me? Will he even close the doors of his kingdom to me? Oh, for if I knew who this scoundrel was, I would pierce his heart with this knife that I hold in my hand. But then again, it could be my own heart that appears. God, grant that this not be so. Still, I keep wondering and asking myself, Lord, is it I? Is it I?
After Jesus called Peter and Andrew to follow him, well, he came to me, John, and my brother James. We were in a boat nearby with our father, and we followed him. And since that day, I've tried to understand Jesus by loving him. Sometimes I believe that he is, well, as much of God as could possess any human life. And then other times, oh, I am tempted to believe that he is the God that existed prior to creation and who will continue to exist long after the end of all time and the consummation of the age. That he is the word that God would speak to every person in every age for all time to come. And yet, I love him as a person. And he hath returned my love. He sometimes calls me the beloved disciple. I have been with him through his trials, as well as his hours of victory. I was with him on the Mount of Transfiguration as we beheld his glory. He nicknamed my brother James and me the Sons of Thunder. Although we are not boisterous men, but rather quiet, hard workers. Although at times we have been a bit impatient with those who had rejected Jesus. Peter and I, we have completed all the arrangements for this celebration of Passover here in this upper room tonight, as he hath numbered us within his close, intimate inner circle. I remember the talk that Jesus told me about that he had with Nicodemus, where he spoke those wonderful words, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Someday I would like to write down some of the many great deeds that Jesus has done so that others may read. And in that reading, that perhaps they will come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And in that belief, they may come to find new life in his name. But now tonight, Jesus has said that one of us is a betrayer. I cannot believe it. Although he would not have said it if it were not so. But who could it be? Surely not my brother, James. Or Peter? Or Andrew? Or could it be John, the beloved disciple? Is it I? Is it I?
I am James, brother of John. One day nearly 3 years ago, he called to us while we mended our nets by the Sea of Galilee with our father Zebedee. We were honored that Jesus wanted us as his disciples. And we were humbled when he chose the both of us to be among the 12 apostles. You see, I was there in Peter's home, when Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law of her fever. And later, I was with him in the home of Jairus when he raised his little daughter from the sleep of death. At the Mount of Transfiguration, we saw him speaking with Moses and Elijah. With Moses and Elijah. Our mother Salome was very ambitious on our behalf. And she urged us to press our claims upon Jesus. So, en route to Jerusalem last week, we made this request of him. Teacher, make us to be seated one at the right and the other at the left when you come into your kingdom. But Jesus responded, you do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink of the cup that I am to drink? Or to be baptized with the baptism which I am baptized? And we responded, Lord, we are able. I am able. And Jesus said, surely you shall drink of the cup that I am to drink and be baptized with the baptism which I am baptized. But it was not within his power to grant the privilege of being seated one at the right and the other at the left when he came into his kingdom. The others, they were angry when they heard of our request. But Jesus said that he who would be first must first be servant to all. And he demonstrated his words by washing our feet just before the supper. These feet. And knowing that, you must also know that there was a time when the people of a certain Samaritan village did not receive him as we thought they should. So we asked, I asked, that he would call down fire from heaven and destroy them. But Jesus rebuked us, as only he could. And he taught that God's way was always one of love. And now he who has taught us of love is to be betrayed by one of those whom he has loved. Who can it be? Why would one of us do such a thing? Still, if I dare to look deep within my own human heart, I must ask myself if to die. Oh, Master, is it I?
I am Thomas, called Didymus, which means twin. Now, I don't look upon life with gloom and despair, but I need to see before I believe. I need proof before committing myself, yet I'm not a man of doubt. Rather, I like to think of myself as a man of daring. See, I remember the time when Mary and Martha sent word that their brother Lazarus was dead. Jesus said, let us go to him. Now, we all knew of the growing opposition to Jesus, and the others shrank away from the unseen danger. But I rebuked them all, saying, let us go with him so we may die with him. Why do people remember my doubts and not my daring? Remember my questions and not my affirmations? Remember my fear. Forget my faith. I've often gone fishing with the others, and I have seen him rebuking the waves of a stormy Galilee. And I have seen him healing the lame, curing the diseased, opening the eyes of the blind, unstopping the ears of the deaf, and preaching the gospel to the poor. Still, opposition to Jesus has grown into a white heat. His enemies want to destroy him. Why? Because the God that he reveals to us is much greater than those petty little man-made deities that they have enshrined upon the altars of their temples and their hearts. He would make us God's servants, while they would make God their servant. But yet, even amongst us, his chosen 12, he says there's going to be a betrayer. Is he talking about me? Is he referring to me? Is he blaming me for lack of courage, for lack of faith? Is it I, Master? Is it I?
My name is James. But since many men have that familiar name, my father was named Alpheus. Since he was named Alpheus, I am sometimes known as James, the son of Alpheus. Our family is a proud one. Our ancestry traced back to the tribe of Gad, one of the 12 sons of Jacob. I will never forget the day I saw the Master. I was passing down the road near the place where John was baptizing, and I was curious to see what was going on. And I turned aside, and I saw John and Jesus. And Jesus asked John to baptize him. John refused. Jesus insisted. After John had baptized the Lord, the heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in the sign of a dove. And we heard a great voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Later, Jesus called me to be one of his disciples. I followed him. And after a whole year of his first ministry, Jesus chose me to be one of his apostles, one of the 12 apostles. Since that moment, I walked with him, talked with him, ate with him, trying to learn as much about him and his Heavenly Father as I could. And now, one of us is going to betray him? Surely it is madness to think about who this betrayer could be. Surely the betrayer is out of his mind. And I keep asking myself, is it I? Lord, is it I?
I am Thaddeus, one of the disciples Jesus called to be an apostle. The 12 tribes of Israel took their names from the sons of Jacob, who was renamed Israel. In like manner, he chose 12 of us to become the cornerstones of the new kingdom, just as the 12 tribes were the cornerstones of the old Jewish kingdom. I feel unworthy to be numbered among the apostles, but he chose me. I well remember the day. After a night in prayer, he called us to him. He gave us authority over unclean spirits and the power to heal every kind of disease and infirmity. He then commissioned us to go forth and preach that the kingdom of heaven was at hand. He told us to be wise as serpents and innocent as doves, since he was sending us forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. It is enough, he said, that the disciple be like his teacher and a servant of his master. I was in Jerusalem when he gave the great invitation, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly at heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Now he who came to share in men's burdens has burden thrust upon him, the knowledge that one of us will betray him. Which one of us could it be? Who is the traitor? Or will all of us betray him before the night is over? Philip? Peter? Judas? John? Even Thaddeus? Is it I? Is it I?
All of the others came from Galilee. My home is in the village of Kerioth. Hence I am known as Judas of Kerioth or Judas Iscariot. The only Judean in the group. The others must have had confidence in me. Simply because Jesus had chosen me to be numbered among the 12. And despite what others may say about me, behind my back, about my stinginess and ambition, Jesus believed in me. Well, if he had not, surely he would have merely chosen someone else to be in my place. Some say that I have appropriated these funds for my own personal use, and that Jesus' words about the love of money and greed were personally directed at me. And still others are always reminding me that Jesus was referring to me when he said, "Did I choose you 12, and one of you is a devil?" Well, of course I complained when Mary washed his feet in that expensive ointment and perfume. I still think it was a horrible waste of money. And if I conspired with the chief priests, and if I happened to have coins of silver on my person, well, that is my own affair. But do not misunderstand me. No. For you see, I believe in Jesus. I do. But someone has to force the issue. Yes, make him assert himself as God's Messiah. But sadly, he refuses to make such a move. Well, I have been for him. He hints that he knows what I have done. He said as much when he washed our feet, and only moments ago when we dipped our bread into the same dish. But hear me. I have my reasons. My soul is not as black as most of you would believe. But then again, neither are your souls as white. What would you do if you were in my place and wanted him to do something dramatic and startling to usher in his kingdom? What would you do? And what would you do if you were in his place? What would you do? I mean, should I ignore his remarks? Or should I, like all the others, piously, self-righteously, ask myself, is it I? Is it I?
It is as you have said. That which you would do, do it quickly.
But Master, all I was...
Judas, that which you would do, do it quickly.
Very well.
Thus, the painting is complete. 12 ordinary men of 12 different moods and personalities, each wondering whether he would betray the master. 11 of the 12 would be faithful. They would spread the good news of the Christ to the utmost parts of the world. Some would go to Europe, some to Africa, and some would even go to India and Persia. 10 of the 11 would die martyrs' deaths. These 11 ordinary men would become known as the apostles, and their efforts would be the beginning of Christianity. Can you see yourself in one of these disciples? Perhaps the impulsive Peter, who was quick to speak but slow to reflect. Or perhaps the quiet and shy Andrew. Or the prejudiced Simon, the zealot. Or the wealthy Matthew. These ordinary men were able to accomplish great deeds through their faith in Christ. Will you be faithful to the Master, or will you betray him? On the night of his betrayal, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. He gave it to the disciples, saying,
"This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat."
Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying,
"This is my blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink." You call me master and teacher, and you do well, for so I am. But if I then, your teacher, have washed your feet, you then also should wash each other's feet. For I shall not be with you much longer. And where I am going, you cannot follow. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that the world might bear witness that you are my disciples. As it has been given unto them, so shall it be given unto you.
The anchor holds. spite of the storm. I had visions, and I had dreams, and I even held them in my hand. But I never knew they would slip right through, like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds, though the sea is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have been young, but I'm older now, and there has been beauty these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my, that's when God proved His love for me. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face raging sea.
Come.